You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello and welcome back. My name is Sergio Soto. This is Sociology 101, the individual in society. This is our second broadcast. And today we'll discuss methodology, the science behind the sociology, behind our field of study. And we'll start our discussion on culture. Now, before we begin, we know some of our students who are taking the course don't have access or do not have access to Blackboard yet. You basically don't have your usernames set up for you. But not to worry, we will make sure that you are not penalized. You'll have an opportunity to, contribute and to take part in the class and receive a fair grade. We just ask for a little bit of time. By the end of the week, we should have everything settled and straightened out. So again, if you can't access Blackboard yet, many of your mentors have access. You can access some of the material, but nonetheless, you will not be penalized. We'll make sure that you have sufficient time to turn in your work and participate in discussions and all that great stuff. Now, moving on. Today our discussion is going to begin with sociology as a science, right? And although this may be a little dry and cut, we do encourage everybody to call in, to contribute, to ask questions. And how you do that is you can call 800-339-1193. Or, if you don't have access to a telephone or, at the moment, or prefer to submit a text response or question, you can email us or send us a message by Twitter. Again, this is a live show. Well, not show, a class, right? But, everyone in our community is welcome to participate, whether you are taking the class for a grade or not, right? We are, broadcasting live all over, the world, really. But, if something strikes your interest, or if you'd like more in-depth detail, or you just want to share your observations or your insights, please do call in, write in, and share your thoughts with us. Okay, everyone is welcome. This is a open classroom. So, sociology as science. Now, we discussed theory last week, and, the thing about our science is that it's grounded by theory. It's the way we frame discussions and arguments, and really it gives us an insight into the world. When it first emerged, in the early 20s at the, University of Chicago, there were two, we can kind of define the science by going two ways. One is, following what Robert Park would argue that he wanted from his sociology students, where he wanted them to wear out the shoe leather in their shoes, right? Basically going out, and getting to know people at an intimate level, right? This is one part of sociology, and you'll see how it branches out, right? This is the more, when we talk about ethnography later on, or the micro, sociology is about the individual, the interactions that take place every day, and how we understand ourselves in the world, right? Next week we'll talk about the development of self identity and how it is balanced out by social identity. Why we see ourselves as individuals, or why we feel we belong to groups, right? Or we'll juxtapose a little bit more with different kinds of scenarios, but that was Robert Park's view. His colleague, right, William Ogburn, believed findings needed to be quantified, right? So sociology's primary goal should be to discover new knowledge rather than make the world a better place to live, right? And this is one of those, this is a dichotomy we still deal with, right? But when we think about qualitative and quantitative research, right, qualitative is very, it's more specific. It's, the name in there is like quality, right? You get very detail-rich data, right? you know, through interviews or getting to know people. And it's very specific, but it can't be just generalized, right? Like you can't sit, you know, quantitative data, like surveys, right? Where people bubble in or answer, according to specific sets of pre-prepared, answers, right? We'll discuss that as we go. But right there, you know, the purpose of sociology is, you know, sometimes it can be problematic, right? You know, when we think about bias, right? In science, we want to control for bias, right? So, you know, if you have a cause that's very close to you, right? Of course, you want to study it, but, you know, how much of your bias will lead you astray, or, you know, how can you compensate for it? Because we're supposed to, in science, you have to be objective. You know, this is stuff we have to deal with in, you know, in the behavioral sciences, right? You know, many times we are drawn to the field or profession that we want to have a career in because of life experiences, right? Or trying to explain, you know, why, you know, certain phenomena occur. So, you know, you can consider something like poverty, right? You know, one might be attracted to sociology because they want to, you know, they might want to alleviate poverty or help explain it. But at the same time, you know, like if you grew up poor or experienced poverty, you know, you have to wonder, you know, how much of your argument is construed or swayed by bias. And the other side is you can't just quantify it, right? You know, it's one thing to say, okay, so many people living under, you know, a certain poverty level of, you know, or making a certain amount of income are considered poor, right? But what then? What if you have percentages of 51%, 30%, or, you know, so many, like one out of five children experience this or that? You know, those are numbers. What does it feel like, right? What do people who live in poverty or who experience poverty, you know, think about? What are their stresses? What are their strategies? How do they survive it, right? This is stuff you can't really necessarily gain through, you know, just quantitative methods, right? You know, you might have to go out there and ask some tough questions. But anyway, we're going to explore this as we go on through the first half of the class. But again, you know, sociology is a science, right? You know, so like any science, we use the scientific method. It's empirical investigation. We analyze data. We make, we think theoretically. And the logical assessments of the arguments, are developed and turned in, you know, and contribute to the body of knowledge about a particular, you know, subject matter. And it can be reviewed by, and is reviewed by, the peers inside, the discipline, you know, ergo peer-reviewed study. So, you know, sociology is a scientific endeavor. You know, we use scientific method, right? We start off with a hypothesis, you know, the same one, you know, any other science uses. We analyze data. We, there's some other steps. Like before you start a research project, you want to make sure you go into, you do a literary review to make sure you aren't doing work or, you know, that's already been done too much, or if it's been done before, you can see what strategies you can use to, you know, aid you in your own research, right? So you want to see what's already been published. You know, it makes your work easier, but we're going to talk about that as we go on, right? So when we think about analyzing data, we often think about like statistics, right? So what we want to do first today, as we explore this empirical data, is we're going to watch a short video with Hans Rosling, right? And he's going to show us the joy of stats. He's going to share with us his passion, and we're going to see how, you know, numbers, you know, gathered through public records, through surveys, you know, a number of ways, right, can be used to construct a generalized view of the world, right? You know, we'll explore that and what it can mean and how it can help illuminate our understanding of the social world. And, you know, in sociology, we deal with probability, you know, the probabilities of certain events happening in a person's life or the life chances that influence, their experience. So let's take a look at that now, and then we'll be right back.
Visualization is right at the heart of my own work too. I teach global health. And I know having the data is not enough. I have to show it in ways people both enjoy and understand. Now, I'm going to try something I've never done before. Animating the data in real space with a bit of technical assistance from the crew.
So, here we go. First, an axis for health. Life expectancy, from 25 years to 75 years. And down here, an axis for wealth, income per person, $400,000, $4,000, and $40,000. So down here is poor and sick, and up here is rich and healthy. Now, I'm going to show you the world 200 years ago, in 1810. Here come all the countries. Europe brown, Asia red, Middle East green, Africa south of Sahara blue, and the Americas yellow. And the size of the country bubble showed the size of the population. And in 1810, it was pretty crowded down there, wasn't it? All countries were sick and poor. Life expectancy were below 40 in all countries. And only the UK and the Netherlands were slightly better off, but not much. And now, why start the world? The Industrial Revolution makes countries in Europe and elsewhere move away from the rest. But the colonized countries in Asia and Africa, they are stuck down there. And eventually, the Western countries get healthier and healthier. And now, we slow down to show the impact of the First World War and the Spanish flu epidemic. What a catastrophe! And now I speed up through the 1920s and the 1930s. And in spite of the Great Depression, Western countries forge on towards greater wealth and health. Japan and some others try to follow, but most countries stay down here. Now, after the tragedies of the Second World War, we stop a bit to look at the world in 1948. 1948 was a great year. The war was over, Sweden topped the medal table at the Winter Olympics, and I was born. But the differences between the countries of the world was wider than ever. United States was in the front, Japan was catching up, Brazil was way behind, Iran was getting a little richer from oil, but still had short lives. And the Asian giants, China, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Indonesia, they were still poor and sick down here. But look what is about to happen. Here we go again. In my lifetime, former colonies gained independence, and then finally they started to get healthier and healthier and healthier. And in the 1970s, then countries in Asia and Latin America started to catch up with the Western countries. They became the emerging economies. Some in Africa follows. Some Africans were stuck in civil war and others hit by HIV. And now we can see the world today in the most up-to-date statistics. Most people today live in the middle, but there are huge differences at the same time between the best of countries and the worst of countries. And there are also huge inequalities within countries. These bubbles show country averages, but I can split them. Take China, I can split it into provinces. There goes Shanghai. It has the same wealth and health as Italy today. And there is the poor inland province Guizhou. It is like Pakistan. And if I split it further, the rural parts are like Ghana in Africa.
And yet, despite the enormous disparities today, we have seen 200 years of remarkable progress. That huge historical gap between the West and the rest is now closing. We have become an entirely new converging world. And I see a clear trend into the future. With aid, trade, green technology and peace, it's fully possible that everyone can make it to the healthy, wealthy corner.
Well, what you just seen in the last few minutes is a story of 200 countries shown over 200 years and beyond. It involved plotting of 120,000 numbers. Pretty neat, huh?
All right, so welcome back. So right there, we saw how statistics can give us an idea of our world, of how we experience it, or how people experience it, right? Here, global health was the focus, and you know, we had variables like poverty, you know, and its influence on life chances, you know, the ability of a person to live a long life, a healthy life, and you know, it you know, kind of shapes our view of what the world is and might become, right? You know, for many of you, you know, you're still young. Well, you're young, right? And this is kind of a snapshot of, you know, the future, right? So, you know, you have to ask yourself questions like, okay, what might you experience in the future because of this? How might the economy change because of this, right? Now you have emerging countries, you know, sometimes we call them the BRICS, like Brazil, Russia, China, India, and, you know, how might they shape not only what you consume, but, you know, the resources that are competed for, right? How we understand ourselves, right? You know, now we have more and more, you know, tourists from, you know, these BRIC countries, right? Like from China and things like that, right? You know, or, you know, we can even question, you know, how, you know, Western hegemony is challenged by this, right? But again, you know, those are, you know, quantified, that's quantified data, right? If we take the quality, you know, if we ask some qualitative questions, like what is it, you know, like to live in the Congo, or what is that, how does that inequality feel like within China, right? Between Shanghai and some of the other provinces, okay? Or even here in the United States, right? You know, you can ask yourself a question, you know, to a certain extent, a lot of folks who are taking a class or watching us at home, you know, live in LA County, right? You know, we all know, you know, which neighborhoods are socioeconomically deprived, or we can call them poor, and which are more affluent, you know, rich neighborhoods. What is experience there like? You know, we can look at data and see gross, you know, the average income, or how many people rent and own property. You know, that's a very good indicator. If the majority of people rent, chances are they're not very wealthy, right? Wealth is indicative of, you know, wealth and owning property kind of go hand in hand, right? That's kind of one of the formulas, right? You can go into, you know, and then you could do some like ethnographic research, or you actually can go into the neighborhoods and see what it's like, right? You know, what kind of stores are there? What do they stock their shelves with? And you can triangulate all this to tell a story. And that's basically one thing sociologists try to do. We try to tell a story about our world, right? We try to illuminate, you know, what's going on. And, you know, sometimes, you know, it's used for political reasons to get certain policies passed or prevent certain policies. But at the very least, when you take this class, it's, you know, one of those, you'll develop tools and an understanding to kind of reveal that hidden world, or at least think beyond it and question, you know, how it really works. So anyway, when we think about theory, right? Theory is our best explanation that we have for certain phenomena, certain social phenomena that people produce in our world, right? Whether it's through interaction or studying things like the economy, right? When we look at economy, with the economy, you know, usually you can see the stock market and things like that. They're just numbers. But, you know, you have to also understand that the economy is made up of people trading, people interacting, you know, whether it's you going to a department store to buy back to school clothes, or, you know, people losing or, you know, losing jobs or being hired, right? All those personal experiences go up into, you know, these jobs reports that get released, a couple times every quarter, every month. And, you know, that's telling a story. At one level, you know, it's about someone's experience. At the other, it's about this collective experience where we can measure, you know, the health of the economy, right? But again, theory is problematic when you, frame the world, right? And the reason it's problematic is because people, you know, are dynamic. People have free will. They're aware of their situation. You know, they're self-aware, and they have intention. So even when people are studied, like in an experimental setting, if they know, you know, that a certain variable is, you know, being observed, or they know that certain characteristics are being looked at, you know, their behavior will change, right? And we'll explore that as we go on. But again, you know, studying humans is something that we can all do, something we do already, right? If you watch people, you ask questions, right? We do, you know, one of the great things about sociology is that our laboratory is everywhere, right? Many of the concepts after today that we are going to discuss, even to, you know, when we talk about culture, are things that you can connect to your everyday experience, right? So this is definitely, you know, why I, you know, love the field, and hopefully we can, you know, share that together. Anyway, now what we're going to do next is we're going to look at a study as shown in the film Freakonomics, and we're going to talk about it. We're going to break it apart, and as we go through the different steps of the research process, we're going to kind of think about what it really means and how research can kind of illuminate, again, these individual experiences in everyday life. How an experiment or a study can help, give some validity to some of the arguments that exist inside the community. Because, you know, one of the things about trying to define a social problem, you know, usually when we think about studying, studies in sociology, it's often trying to illuminate a social problem, right? When does it get to, you know, when does it become defined as a problem, right? If we think back to the sociological imagination, right? We learn that personal troubles can be connected or are connected to public issues. But when does that public issue become so important or gets the attention that requires, you know, government action or community action, right? Like, if you lose a job, is it just you? Or is it connected to a process that's much bigger than you? Like a failing economy, right? So we're going to kind of look at race right now. We're going to look at race and we're going to look at employment. And I won't give away too much of the next video, but think about what the variables are, right? What elements are influencing each other. Think about how race plays a role in the economy. So let's take a look at that video and then we'll be right back.
World-renowned economist and a leading expert on race in America, Fryer has long been interested in what he calls cultural segregation, the gap between white culture and black culture.
One embodiment of that culture is what you name your kid. It's probably one of the few cultural items that we can really measure precisely. What we did was we looked at the effects of your kid's first name on their life outcomes.
Dr. Fryer analyzed the naming records of every baby born in the state of California over the last 40 years, and those names tell an unmistakable story. African American parents are more likely than any other ethnic group to give their children unique names.
There is definitely a distinction between names for white people and names for black people.
Black names be like Malik, Jaquan, Nayshawn, Naheem.
Tasha and Shamika.
Shaniquas and the Nayshawns and the Kayshawns.
I know this girl, her name is Treasure, T-R-E-Z-U-R-E. Struck me as typically, you know, more African-American name.
I like the names that begin with S-H-A, like Shaheem, Shahid, Shamar.
Shaquem, Shakur. You know, Oprah is popular.
It was actually in the 50s, in the early 60s, that we saw huge overlaps in the naming patterns of blacks and whites. So people, you know, naming their kids John, Michael, names like that. And what you saw was around 1968 or so, kind of the Black Power movement, actually, you saw distinct bifurcation with black names getting more distinctively black, and a lot of them were Islamic names. Because the Black Power movement was about identity. Who are we? Who are you? Are you part of us? It wasn't until the late 80s and 90s that we started to get, you know, kind of the made-up, concatenated names that you see now.
This generation today, they sort of changed the whole name concept. They have names that are 30 letters long, you know, and
Now, everybody tried to do something, how do you say, unique. They tried to name their kid over something different, you know?
Okay, so welcome back. Right there, names, right? A name is something very personal, very unique. You know, when parents decide on a name for a child, it's not a process that is just taken, you know, for granted or any name just given, right? You know, name will follow you through your life, right? But within culture, right, we often have to wonder, okay, well, you know, what do names mean, right? So without going, first, before we go into race, just think about how names are gendered first, right? How some names are strictly for males and other names are for females, right? And going further, like how a name can reflect a person's ethnicity, a race, their cultural, cultural position, right? Their position in the stratified system, okay? And now what we do here is, you know, this is kind of like a, you know, connecting, you know, statistics and experience or history, right? You know, we theorize that, or it's theorized that the change in names, again, as argued here, in black names, the uniqueness of the names, or a lot of the names were correlated with, you know, the black empowerment movement in the late 60s and 70s, right? So naming your child became a, you know, could be an act of resistance, an act of, cultural awareness, right? So here, you know, even though, you know, it's something as mundane as a name, right? Data is used, you know, historical analysis is used, you know, actual hard numbers are, brought together to tell a story, to argue, you know, that certain phenomenon is going on. In that same film, or in that same book, you know, Freakonomics, there's also a study of people's names. We'll, you know, watch this together when we get to our, you know, section on race. But one of the questions is, can a name keep you from getting a job, right? What the study found, that indeed it can. If you have a black name or something that's recognized as a black name, it can keep you, you know, searching on the job market for a few extra weeks, as opposed to a name that is considered white, right? And how they did this, they controlled, the applications, the resumes, everything was the same, but the name, right? So, you know, you get this statistical data, but, you know, we can also, again, going back to that same question, what does it mean for the people who are experiencing this, right? Some of you, you know, you might want to share your, like, what you know about your name. Like, why did your parents name you what they named you, right? Is it cultural, you know? I've had students in the past, when we watch this or discuss this together, where they tell me that, you know, their parents purposely named them, you know, a very generic, very, you know, white name, you know, my African-American students or otherwise, a very white name, in order for them to not have to constantly deal with race on, you have to constantly deal with race, but, you know, kind of just to alleviate it. But at the same time, do you, you know, is that, you know, surrendering to, you know, cultural hegemony? Is that, how do you, you know, as a parent, you know, come to terms with that? Anyway, you know, and it's not only that, you know, women's names, things like that, you know, it's always, you know, one of those things. But again, you can call in, you can write in, share your perspectives. Now, we're going to start discussing the process of, you know, our scientific method. One thing I want to discuss before we move on is, you know, I want to kind of shed some light, or have you all think about claim making, right? So not only in science, but everyday life, it's always easier to make a claim, right, than it is to prove it. Like, for example, I can, you know, make something up and say, like, I'm able to, you know, fly or something. I don't know, right? So how would you test that? Well, you know, you might throw me off, not too tall of a building, but you might throw me off a building and I won't fly. So anyway, you might have to test it, right? The point is that, well, maybe that's a bad example. I'll think of another one as I, you know, discuss this, right? The point is that whenever someone makes a claim, it takes more work to disprove it, right? So like in sociology, we can making claim that names influence, you know, your opportunities in life, right? If you're given a name that is strong ethnically or culturally, it may alienate you from, you know, joining certain groups because of people's pre-existing prejudices and the stereotypes that exist in society, right? So that's, you know, very general, right? So how do we prove it, right? How do we go in and see, okay, whether is this just an individual experience, or is this really happening at a systematic level where many people in a society are experiencing the same issue, right? And that's where the science comes in, right? Both are important, the qualitative and the quantitative, but again, together, you know, they illuminate our understanding of the world. So anyway, we're gonna go through the different parts. You know, first, before you start your research project, you define a problem, okay? This is something that can be problematic, but it can, you know, it's something that you can approach as deductive or inductive, right? You can start with a question and go out and search for the answers, search for what's really going on, or you can go out there and let the research speak to you. Let it tell you what's going on. Let it tell you what are the issues that a community or a group of people or a phenomenon that, if it exists in society, you know, entails. Okay? So the next step is to review the evidence. This is a literary review. You familiarize yourself with existing research on the topic. Now, there are several reasons you do this, right? One is to point you in the right direction. Now, one of the, you know, I don't know if it's fair to say a misconception, but yeah, I guess it is, you know, in science, is that all research is new, totally new, right? One thing to remember in all of, you know, all science is that knowledge is built on the knowledge that came before it, right? So when you do a research review, or you review the evidence that exists already, you know, you are saving yourself work, but not only that, carrying on the legacy of those who, you know, came before you. And what you'll find in your, you know, review is that, you know, it's going to help you frame the issue theoretically. It's going to show you what methodology has worked successfully and maybe not so successfully, right? That'll save you some work, some headaches. But more importantly, you know, you'll know which questions have been posed, need or still need answering. Or maybe you might do the, you know, literary review, you might do review the evidence and decide that, you know, your gut instinct tells you, or what you know or what you feel tells you, that, you know, the existing knowledge is wrong. So you, now you know, the point at which you will, you know, argue, you know, whatever you choose to, right? And the other thing about, you know, research is, so I don't forget, you know, it's not important whether you are right or wrong at the end of the day, once you, you know, figure out your hypothesis, right? Because it's just as important, you know, if you're right. I mean, if you're right, it's just as important if you're wrong, right? You know, you are expanding the knowledge on the subject and, you know, helping a whole field move forward. So after you review the evidence, you, you know, work out the design, you hypothesize and develop what questions you're going to ask. And when we work out the design, we'll talk about this a little bit later on. You choose a, you know, one or two or maybe even three, depending on how many resources you have, research methods, right? Usually one, but you can do experiment, survey, observation, use existing sources, and we'll discuss those in detail as we move forward. Once you work out the design, you carry out the research. This is where you actually do the work. If you're gonna do ethnographic research, you go out into the community. If you do data collection, that's when you administer the surveys or whatever research instrument you choose to use. And then you interpret the results, right? You take it back to your office, you know, our lab, right? And you, you know, figure out what you found out, right? So you interpret the results, right? The implications of whatever data you collected, what it means in the broader scale of, you know, your research project. And then you report the findings, right? What are their significance? What did you find? What did you discover? What were you wrong about? What were you right about? And what questions do you have yet to answer? You know, that's one of the great things, right? Once you start a research project, it's usually entirely different from what you started with, right? It evolves, it changes, you change with it. You know, you learn from this process. So, you know, when you go into academia, it's a process of learning. You never stop learning, right? So, you know, in reality, you know, the process isn't smooth. It's not step by step. There's a lot of, you know, pitfalls that can, you know, challenge the researcher, right? And, you know, and it's something that, you know, whenever, you know, you read a piece of research or as you read your text, you know, it's something to appreciate, you know, even though it might be just a paragraph or a chapter, you know, understand that people, you know, have dedicated their lives to this endeavor, right? To illuminate the social world. And it's not a bad career either. So anyway, those are the steps, and we'll talk about some of the methodology as we go. That's what's going to be really important. So our next point is going to be to discuss understanding cause and effect, right? So the relationship between two events or situations is associated, and you know, can be associated with one situation and a situation that produces another. So cause and effect, right? So causation and correlation. Whenever we think of causation and correlation, usually we think of, okay, one variable creating an effect or influencing the other. But we have to be careful with correlation, right? Such things as like spurious correlations exist. This is where, you know, we may be misguided by, you know, two variables seemingly influencing each other. Like the example I like to give, and I forget, this is not an original idea. I forget right now where I originally heard it, but I'll give you for example, right? And keep in mind that, this is spurious. This is not, really going on, but it's an example of how one might be led astray if all the variables aren't accounted for. So the example I like to use is, say I'm a researcher, right? And I'm measuring intelligence in children from age 5 to 7. And what I do is I follow a cohort of children, you know, a small group of children, you know, through those 3 years, right? I do this at 20 different sites. I have a research budget and all that, and I send graduate students out to do this. And what I do is I measure their IQ with a test at the beginning and end of every semester. And I measure their feet, right? Their shoe size at the beginning and end of every semester. And I find that as their shoe size increases the first year, so does their IQ. So I do it again the next year. IQ test, beginning and end of the school year, measure the shoe size again, and I find the same thing, right? Shoe size goes up, and IQs go up. There's a correlation there. So third year, same exact thing, right? The shoe size goes up, and the IQs go up, right? And since I'm dealing just with these two variables, I might tell myself, well, you know, there's a relationship right there. IQ is directly influenced by the growth of the feet. And I argue that shoe size, the speed at which feet grow, influences a child's IQ. Right, this is spurious. This is not really what's going on. But what is going on? Right? Now, we don't, you know, if you can write in and, you know, give me different variables of what's going on. But the one thing I'm leaving out is education. Right? What do all these children have in common? They're all going through this process of education, right? They're going to school, they're being taught. That's really what's influencing IQ, right? So how will we control for this, right? Like, okay, say you really had to, you know, challenge me. Say I had a lot of prestige, but although I was very wrong, you had to knock me off my high horse. Well, you would have to find a situation where, you know, children aren't receiving education, right? And measure their shoes and IQs, and you'll see that they basically stay the same or they stagnate, right? That would be your control. Well, you know, luckily everyone would, most people see the connection, see how it's spurious, but it's also very dangerous. You know, this happens in science all the time, right? You know, data isn't interpreted correctly, and that's why the peer review process is so important. You know, folks go in and they look at, you know, what the other researchers may have missed, or whether there was any bias, or even if, you know, there might be a number off, a number off or a formula off inside their Excel spreadsheets. You know, this has happened even to folks who publish at Harvard, right? You know, just recently, you know, a liberal economic model was, taken down because, you know, they found that they had made some miscalculations or used the wrong formula in their Excel sheet. But anyway, so these are, you know, you can, whenever you do a research, a research project, or you actually do research, you know, you have controls, you know, you control some variables. These are things that you can measure. And there's two kinds of variables, right? Two flavors, if you will. An independent variable, right? The independent variable is the one that you generally have control over as far as it influencing your research project, the one you can choose or manipulate. And it's what you think is influencing the other type of variable, the dependent variable, right? The dependent variable is the one that responds to the independent variable. Think about depends. It's right there. You know, it depends on the independent variable. So it has an influence. It's cause. You know, it has some causation, or it's the independent variable is having some influence on it, right? So, you know, when we think about something like poverty, right? Someone's existence in poverty, right? We could say, okay, that's the dependent variable, right? How poor someone, a person's poor. But the independent variable would be, okay, what's causing the poverty, right? You can ask yourself this. Okay, we know what poor looks like, at least culturally, right? But what are some of the factors that contribute to it? Is it unemployment, the economy, right? Motivation, right? And these are, you know, that's just one example of what we can kind of think about. Anyway, moving forward, let's talk about the different research methods. Ethnography, okay? This is firsthand studies of people using participant observation or interviewing, right? People actually go onto the field, they talk to people, they become part of group activities. Sometimes they, to the extent that folks will go out and live with a community, okay? This is experiencing what the community experiences. Right? So the advantages are, you know, the biggest advantage is that the data that is collected is extremely rich and in-depth, right? And it provides a very deep understanding of the social processes that create certain social situations, right? Like, for example, if you want to study gangs, you might follow, you know, gang members around. You might ask them questions throughout the day, right? And they'll tell you what they believe or how they feel about certain things. You observe their everyday life, you know, through your own eyes, right? So, you know, very deep and rich, data is gathered. But the disadvantage is that, you know, of course, because of the time constraints and, you know, you're only one researcher, a small research group, you know, the data, the study is only really reflective of the small group or community that you culled the data from, or that you researched, right? So generalizations become problematic, right? You can't just say, oh, this is what every gang experiences, or every group experiences, or every member or community experiences. It's very good for that community, but can you say it's applicable to another community, on the other side of the United States, or even 20 years from now, right? For instance, you know, I could survey the students here at Cal State Dominguez about something like parking, right? Parking's really kind of has been problematic for the first couple of weeks, and they might say something, parking's the worst thing ever, it's terrible, right? And it might be their number one concern. However, if I asked a person, you know, or the same group of, or same, you know, sample, the same question at the University of Long Beach or, you know, somewhere on the East Coast, right? Like, say the East Coast. Their issue might not be parking, especially, you know, in cities like New York or anywhere that has, you know, a dependency of public transit, right? Their issues might be, you know, getting discounted fares for public transit, right? Totally different, right? Because the environment creates a certain situation and, you know, the position everyone is in, right? You know, something that we don't really take into account is how environment influences, you know, our everyday life, right? But, you know, we'll discuss that as we go on throughout the class. The other method, surveys, right? It's a method in which questionnaires are administered to a population being studied, right? These are standardized and, you know, or they can be standardized or open-ended, right? Standardized, the choices are fixed, right? You have a, you know, a preset set of answers, right? You know, either it's a scale of 1 to 10, strongly agree, strongly disagree, no opinion, right? Yes or no, maybes, right? Every answer falls into a slot. Or you can have open-ended where, you know, and this is usually, you know, something that interviews actually use, not so much surveys because then it, you know, becomes a little bit more problematic, but open-ended questions allow the respondent to have a greater freedom in responding, right? Like, for example, a standard questionnaire might ask, you know, your income level, right? Whether you are poor or not, right? But an open-ended question might be, okay, how do you see yourself? So you might see, you know, a discrepancy between a person's income and whether they feel they're middle class or upper class or poor, right? Samples, when you do surveys, samples studying a portion of the individuals or cases from a larger population as representative of that population as a whole. And whenever you sample, you try to, you know, keep it random. That way every person inside that or every member of that population has the same chance of being chosen once you, you know, collect that data, and it's far more representative, right? Because we're trying to eliminate bias, right? If you choose every third name, right, that's a little bit more random, but again, that's, you know, can be biased, right? Fortunately, it's only one chapter and like half a broadcast, so we don't really have time to go into all the issues that you have with bias and trying to correct for it. But it's one of those interesting things, like, you know, say you're taking a survey, you know, and you're administering it in person, right? If you go up to every person, you know, you might think, okay, you're being inclusive, but, you know, it might be biased because of the time of day you chose, right? That might skew the results. Like, if we were still on the issue of parking, if you ask people midday, who might only go to a class midday when parking's kind of alleviated, or very early in the morning, they might not have an issue as opposed to someone who goes at a peak hour, right? You ask those questions. Or, you know, you as a researcher might choose to, you know, interview attractive people, right? So right there, it might be biased, right? Because you're choosing to, you know, speak to those, you know, who you find attractive, right? Anyway, it can be problematic, right? So the advantages, right? Surveys make possible the efficient collection of data on large numbers of individuals, allows for the precise comparisons to be made between the answers of respondents, right? The disadvantages, it can be superficial. Differences between respondents' views may be glossed over by highly standardized questionnaires, and responses may be what people profess to believe rather than what they actually believe. You know, again, people, want to satisfy the researcher, or they don't want to, like, say, embarrass themselves or, you know, give the true information, especially if a person's, like, right in front of them. It's always better to have, like, a computer do it because there's a sense of anonymity. Anyway, next we're going to talk about experiments. But before we do, we're going to watch a short video on the Milgram experiment. This is a very famous experiments for both sociology and psychology. You know, we'll revisit this when we discuss conformity and deviance. And as in, you know, in this experiment, you can kind of think about the different variables that are controlled for and how this artificially constructed situation can give us insight on human behavior, right? The different roles that are going on. And well, without further ado, let's take a look at that now.
Imagine this scenario. You go to a prestigious university to participate in a learning and memory experiment. When you arrive, you discover that the teaching instrument is this machine, which seems to give electroshocks to a man on the other side of the wall. As you move up the scale, he begins to scream out in pain.
The experiment requires that you continue.
The experimenter pressures you to go on. Would you agree to continue?
That's all.
45 years ago, Dr. Stanley Milgram came up with this experiment to test whether people would blindly follow the orders of an authority figure. He found that two-thirds of his subjects were willing to give the most dangerous shock on the machine. We teamed up with Dr. Jerry Berger, a social psychologist at Santa Clara University in California, to see whether people have changed since then.
Wrong. 90 volts.
The typical response is to turn toward the experimenter and, if not say something, at least give a look that says, "What should I do?"
In our new experiment, how many people would agree to follow the orders of an authority figure?
Ow, that's incorrect.
39-year-old Troy Shasker is an electrician. He's been paid $50 to participate and told that the money is his to keep even if he quits the experiment early. He's worried about the dangers of the electroshock machine.
Wow. I don't think I should shock him that hard if he really does screw up. That's been a severe shock there.
Yeah, there are 25.
I mean, I could just go get my shotgun.
There are 20.
In the room next door, Troy watches as the learner gets strapped into his chair and really gets nervous once he hears him say this.
I should probably bring up a couple of years ago at Kaiser, they diagnosed a mild heart condition. I'm really not too worried about it. It's not that serious, but...
Well, you should know that while the shocks that we'll be using today may be painful, they're not dangerous. Okay?
Milgram intended that scripted exchange to set up a conflict in the subject's mind, a choice between the health of the learner and the authority of the experimenter.
Number one.
Then the test begins.
Blue, boy, girl, grass, hat.
The learner must decide which of the four words is the correct match. At first, everything goes smoothly.
Correct.
I was confident that he was doing really good at first, and then it started looking bad.
Then, at 75 volts, Troy hears the first sign of trouble.
Soft. Rug. Pillow. Hair. Grass. Incorrect. 75 volts.
I could actually hear him next door going, ow, oh, and he kept getting things wrong.
Incorrect. 90 volts.
He doesn't like that.
At 105 volts, he's clearly uneasy.
I got a little moist on my forehead there. I wasn't comfortable. I can't tell you why I listened to him and kept going. I should have just said no.
The correct word was duck. Rock, house.
At 150 volts.
Incorrect. 150 volts.
That's all.
Will Troy listen as the learner begs him to stop, or will he follow Brian's orders?
Tell him the correct word, pair of white.
The correct word was white horse.
The next item, please continue.
The next item is sad.
He obeys the orders.
Face?
Why didn't you stop?
I saw him getting strapped in, and they were just like little... I mean, he could have just... If he was in that much pain, he could have just tore himself off.
Why are you putting it on him and not you or the experimenter?
I was just doing my job. I was doing what I was supposed to do.
75 volts.
So, I guess the influence of having the conductor of the experiment right there next to me, telling me to keep going... had a lot to do with it.
For the past 30 years, there have been severe restrictions on using humans in social psychology research. To avoid putting subjects under too much stress, Dr. Berger made a significant change to our experiment.
In this experiment, you stopped at 150 make-believe volts. In Milgram, they went much higher.
We stopped for ethical reasons. We couldn't put people through the agony that Milgram's participants went through.
I told you I had heart trouble. My heart's starting to bother me now.
Are there clues that indicate whether certain people might be more compliant with authority?
Wrong. 90 volts.
When you were watching, how good were you at guessing? Oh, this person may go or this may not.
It was impossible to tell. I tried to guess. I tried to look for signs, body language, anything to try to guess who's going to continue and who's going to stop. And that tells me that it's not that there are certain kinds of people who are obviously different from the rest of us. It tells me that probably all of us are capable.
All right, so welcome back. Right there we saw an experiment, right? The environment was controlled. It was systematic. It was an artificial situation where the researcher controlled what went on, right? Now, this experiment, you know, when originally done by Stanley Milgram, and you know, when he published his work, The Obedience on Obedience and Authority, I think. It really illuminated how people conform, and how people will follow orders, right? From a person with a higher status, you know, regardless of whether they, you know, agree with the action or not, right? Whether they cause harm, right? This is something that we'll discuss when we get into deviance and conformity, right? And like maybe two or three broadcasts if you want to make sure you catch that lecture. But you know, the advantages of this is that specific variables were, you know, controlled by the investigator, and it's usually easier for, you know, the subsequent researchers to repeat it, right? Like here in this example, you know, the same environment was created as it was created when Stanley Milgram conducted his research. Now, there were some changes. Hopefully, we'll have time to talk about the IRB and why ethics are important inside social research, but I might move things along forward and start our discussion on culture right after this in order to get some discussion in and some texts in or emails in, right? One of the disadvantages, many of the aspects of social life can't be brought into the laboratory, and responses of those studies may be affected by experimental settings. And Khalib writes in, I remember seeing this experiment in my psychology class. It's surprising how many people have blind faith when they didn't even know whether the person in the other room was okay. And it's true, right? Social psychology uses, you know, often cites this, Caleb. And, you know, where sociology and psychology meet is right there in social psychology, right? These processes that, you know, enable people to, you know, do horrendous things. You know, one of the things that Milgram was trying to understand is, and a lot of this research on conformity, you know, emerged from, you know, the horrific acts of people during, you know, the Second World War, namely things like the Holocaust, right? The Holocaust, you know, was a very bureaucratic process. And one of the questions was that, okay, well, why did so many people go along with it, right? You know, this was a, you know, state-organized genocide. And, you know, even though people were conscious or objected to it, they still went along with it. And one of the things that frequently emerged inside the, you know, inside the Nuremberg trials was that a lot of folks were, a lot of people who were being prosecuted were, you know, claiming the defense that they were merely following orders, right? Because, you know, that's one thing you can kind of think about. Okay, like, you know, obviously, you know, not every German was evil, right? A lot of people were patriotic. They were following the line. You know, they were trying to be good citizens, right? And they were obeying what their government told them, right? And you can wonder, okay, like, I mean, there's a certain element inside, you know, humanity that, makes us want to conform, right? Conformity is safe. Conformity, to a certain extent, led to, you know, the survival of human society, right? And it's not only like, you know, extremes like this, you know, oftentimes what we see, and this is again something we'll discuss in our very interesting lecture, which will be very interesting, our lecture on conformity. I mean, even when people see something wrong, they don't always speak up, right? The hardest, you know, the most difficult position is to be the first voice of dissent, right? Because that's the one that, you know, risks the most as far as discipline and being criticized, right? If you often see, okay, you know, if someone voices dissent, others are more readily, more ready to join in that dissent if they agree. Because once that group's been established, it's easy for people to join and have some solidarity. But yes, in social psychology, you know, those processes, because it's about human behavior, are studied. And in this experiment, you know, it's shared by sociology and psychology. Now, what I want to do next, just to make sure, since we're at the, you know, we only have about 30 minutes left in the class, so I want to make sure we start a discussion on culture, okay? So what I want to do is start discussing culture. If we have some time, we'll go back and discuss life histories and things of that nature, right? So culture is everything, right? But before we go, Caleb has another, contribution, and he writes that this also reminds of Philip Zimbardo's experiment, the Stanford Prison Experiment, where he had several participants imprisoned, and he tested the deviancy of guards when they were anonymous and when they weren't. Right? We'll look at the Stanford Prison Experiment later on. It discusses it, and that's discussed also in your text. But you know what's also interesting and importance of both sociology and psychology is how, you know, students who went to a prestigious school, who were at least on paper, you know, the type of individuals that you want as a son or daughter, are able to be turned into, you know, in one aspect, the guards were, you know, very aggressive, violent, and dehumanized the prisoners. And the prisoners also took that role of being inferior and things like that. So, I mean, these statuses that we understand in society, right, just adopting them can have a strong influence in who we are, right? In that case, you know, the status of guard and prisoner, you know, influenced the students' behavior greatly, even to the extent that, you know, some of the students later on had, psychological trauma and things like that. But anyway, if we have time, we'll talk about the IRB, how that is used to help protect research subjects. You know, because of these experiments, they can never, you know, because of experiments like this or worse ones like the Tuskegee syphilis experiment, human subjects are protected now because even though science, you know, felt... even though science is noble, sometimes it can hurt people, and people have rights, so we have to respect that, especially, when the research can cause more harm than it does good. But anyway, we're going to kind of jump forward here. If we have time, we'll revisit the ethical questions dealt with, that we deal with when we, you know, study people. But I want to start a discussion on culture today. Okay, so what is culture? Okay, culture, and this is the definition, right? Culture consists of values a given group holds, the language they speak, the symbols they revere, the norms they follow, and the material goods they can create. So culture is everything, right? Culture is the language we use, the gestures I use, the clothes I'm wearing, the desk, the television or monitor, computer monitor that you're watching this lecture on, right? That's all defined, right? So it's not only these concrete materialistic things that we can touch, right? These material goods, but it's also, things you can't touch, things that aren't tangible, like values, norms, ideas, right? You know, for example, a value is an idea that's held by an individual or group that, you know, that is, you know, indicative of whether something's like good or bad, or how to think about a certain situation or certain behavior, right? And values are passed on. You know, one of the things we want to think about is how we understand this, right? And the other thing we've been talking about since the first class are norms, right? These are the rules of conduct that clarify, you know, appropriate behavior in our society or in social situations, right? Think about how we use eye contact, right? When is eye contact appropriate? When is it not appropriate? Think about personal space. You know, these are all things that we're going to discuss. Like, what's too close or what's too far, right? You know, I often, seek to kind of bridge this gap, right, where we, take these things for granted. Like, if you go to a store and you have to stand in line, you know, there are norms that create social order, right, that create a sort of harmony within that situation that keeps people, moving efficiently. And it just takes one person to kind of throw that whole thing off, right? I also think about, like, when you feel awkward, right? You know, sometimes it's because you don't understand norms or someone's violating a norm, right? Awkwardness is, values and norms are abstract. You can't hold them, you can't feel them, you can't touch them. They can have a physiological influence over ourselves, right? Or inside our bodies, right? You know, that's the thing about information. You know, information can come out that, you know, embarrasses you, and you might turn red, you might have this like physical reaction to it. But, it, you know, when you think about it, okay, why are you embarrassed? It's usually because it's, you know, when we talk about identity, we'll talk, you know, discuss how our identities are fragile, right? But not only that, how situations are defined, you know, can spoil our identities, right? So anyway, one thing we want to focus on today and hopefully open it up for discussion is our discussion on material goods in our societies. These are things that we produce, we buy, we share, we consume, we give, right? And all societies create physical goods, right? And, you know, they influence how people live. Now, we want to kind of turn the microscope, if you will, onto our own society and discuss how what we buy, what we consume, you know, is linked to a value system where we kind of create, where it becomes part of our identity, right? Think about logos, brands, and things like that. We'll watch two videos to kind of illustrate this. First will be the overspent American, how competitive consumption kind of defines our life. And from there, we'll kind of open it up for discussion and, you know, watch a short video while you all get to write in or call in. But this is something that we all experience, that we all have to navigate or deal with, and it does define how we feel about ourselves and how we think about others in our world. So without further delay, let's watch a segment on the overspent American. We'll be back, we'll discuss it a little, and then we'll watch another video while you all get to write in, call in, and share your thoughts. So let's take a look at that now.
You're going to have a consumption competition. The people who are involved in it need to know what others have. And the easiest way for them to know what others have is to see it. There are problems when you compete around things that people can't see, like the size of your bank balance, because it's easy to lie about it. It's easy to brag that you have something that you don't. With a conspicuous consumption model, that is, with products that are socially visible, you either have the Lexus or you don't. It's pretty clear. People can see pretty instantly the size of the rock on your finger. They can see how big your house is and so forth. So what has happened is that the kinds of goods that we compete about over time we've gravitated to the goods that are socially visible. I think a lot about what I call the big three: the car you drive, the house you live in, the clothes you put on your body. And as the competitive consumption system spread to a wider and wider group of people, those socially visible items become increasingly important as a part of a competitive consumer system. The commodity where you see this in its most destructive form, of course, is the SUV, sport utility vehicle. And you have large numbers of consumers moving to these vehicles, not because they need to use them off-road, not because they fill them up necessarily, but because they are the trendy vehicle of the moment, and they're dangerous to other drivers on the road. They're extremely detrimental to the environment. They have very low gas mileage and contribute disproportionately to global warming. But you've had a mad rush to them by consumers because of their extraordinary prestige and status value. Housing's been another area of dramatic escalation and upscaling. The average American house has doubled in size since the 1970s, despite the fact that there are a declining number of people living in the houses, so square footage per person has increased dramatically. Luxury subdivisions have been springing up all over the country with only oversized executive style and other fancy homes.
4, 5, and 6,000 square foot McMansions are going up in subdivisions with pools and tennis courts all over the country as Americans play a new game. No longer keeping up with the Joneses, now it's the Gateses.
Houses have also gotten much more luxurious with remodeled kitchens, granite countertops. Bathrooms have gotten much fancier with jacuzzis and steam showers. We've shifted to building 3-car garages, 2 for the cars, 1 for all the stuff that you can't fit in the rest of the house. Eventually, however, people have acquired the houses, the cars, the jewelry, the wardrobe, the watches, and so forth. And the continual pressures of advertising and marketing and to keep up as incomes grow and wealth increased, new products get drawn in to the system of competitive consumption, and things which were previously not really socially visible get drawn in, and marketers and consumers make them visible. So it used to be that water was an unbranded good. There was no status value to water. People took it out of the tap. But water comes to be branded, and you get a whole range of statuses of water. The foreign waters become the most valuable, and people start walking around out on the street and in other public places with their water bottles with labels. Coffee's another one. A couple of decades ago, if you bought coffee at a coffee shop, it would come in a generic cup. All the coffee shops bought the same cup. Now all those cups are branded, and you can tell whether you bought it at Starbucks or whether you just bought it at the old-fashioned, you know, neighborhood coffee shop that still uses that generic cup. Athletic footwear is another example of a product which was previously sort of background and unbranded. People used athletic footwear for sports. It didn't have the status value that your dress shoes did, for example. But once Converse, Nike, Reebok came along, they turned these footwear items into extraordinary examples of status goods in which the name became absolutely everything. These are products that are produced, most of the athletic footwear is produced with the same materials in the same factories according to very similar designs, and yet people will pay $100 more just to have that Michael Jordan logo on it. What's happened in the era of new consumerism is that branding has become all important.
Favorite brands? Krispy Kreme.
I like Home Depot.
Plenty.
Victoria's Secret.
IKEA Furniture.
TiVo.
J.Crew. I like J.Crew. Coca-Cola.
Jaguar.
Gap Jeans.
One of those minis.
Airwalks and Vans.
Kmart. Mini Coopers. Walmart. IMAX.
More and more products are branded. The importance of consuming the right brands has become much greater. Back in the 1950s and 60s, there were no labels on the outside of clothes.
So welcome back. Competitive consumption or conspicuous consumption, right? We all understand this, right? We live in a society that is often criticized for being consumerist. A lot of these labels, you know, we often think of as fashion, but it really is about status, right? The shoes you wear, the clothes you put on your body. You know, we're having a conversation about class, style, culture, right? And this is something we can all, you know, discuss. So if you have an opinion or if you have a viewpoint, you can call in 800-339-1193. Perhaps you're, you know, watching at home and you've seen some of these trends change in your lifetime, right? Think about how cell phones are, you know, status symbols now, or even the carrier that you are on, right? For example, you know, just to kind of clarify it for some of us, you know, we can think about a watch, right? How a watch, because of our culture, because of the value system, because of, you know, our belief system, it's defined by much more than what its intended purpose is. Like, the purpose of a watch is to tell time. So regardless if you get like a $10 plastic watch or a $10,000 watch, right? One of the basic functions is to tell time. However, what sets it apart? What gives one a lower status and the other a higher status, right? You know, it's the cost. It's the shared knowledge that, you know, if it's a Rolex, it's gonna, you know, we know it's expensive. Or when we think about cars, right? Or, you know, you can think about advertising. You know, like cars is a good example. It's not only that, okay, you know, we know that Mercedes are, or Mercedes and BMWs and Ferraris and Porsches are expensive, and perhaps, you know, Hondas and things of that nature aren't as expensive. But within the car industry, one of the, it's not really a secret, but people, you know, they don't really advertise it this way, is that, you know, a company like Toyota will have different brands inside of its, inside of its corporation. So, you know, one of the things that, you know, came about is that Toyota has a luxury brand, right? And I believe it's Lexus, right? You know, so Lexus's cost more, Toyota's cost a little bit in the middle. And just recently they, you know, Toyota launched a lower end brand, but or different style brand. That's not necessarily lower, because you also have to wonder about what each brand, how it's represented in culture, right? Which is like with Scion. Now, this isn't an advertisement. I just, you know, think it's interesting, right? You know, the sportier, you know, cars that maybe young people would be attracted to, or the ones that are a little, you know, more affordable than the mid-range, like Toyotas, are, you know, kind of, you know, put into the Scion brand, you know, the fancier stuff into Lexus. But right there, you know, just with the cars we drive, especially here in Los Angeles County, you know, they are reflective of our, you know, status or our class status, right? How much wealth we have, right? And again, you know, that cannot also, you know, obscure the reality. One of the things about our culture is that, you know, the class division or that class difference is kind of obscured because of credit to a certain extent, or the attainability of some of these items. Like, for example, you know, whether you're, you know, working a minimum wage job or, you know, breaking in hundreds of thousands in on Wall Street, you might own an iPhone, right? Why is that possible? Or why would both be attracted to this idea of an iPhone, right? Because even though, you know, every year, you know, a new iPhone comes out, right? What seduces people is the brand, and that's what's important, the idea. And, you know, companies like Apple or Nike or Microsoft, any of these big corporations spend a lot of money and research into thinking about how to best communicate those ideas, right? When you see a Nike swoosh, you know, ask yourself, what do you think about, right? What do you associate with that? Or, you know, a bottle of Gatorade, what do you associate with that? Or, you know, in the video we looked at bottled water, right? What ideas are associated with it? And to a certain extent, because we experience culture and we know culture, we're able to decipher these, you know, often cryptic but not so cryptic, messages behind each logo. The other thing to kind of keep in mind is how, you know, culture reproduces itself, right? So we're going to kind of maybe step away from material goods, but also think about how environment is linked to culture, right? You can think about the foods people eat, right? Oftentimes, you know, they're linked to what they a society has traditionally available. Like, for example, you know, in Japanese culture, right? And the way we define culture is usually by political domains or the states, right? So, you know, Japan is a nation state, and therefore Japanese culture is what envelops, you know, that nation state, as well as American culture. You know, American culture is, often thought of the culture inside the United States, right? Inside the United States, and we'll discuss this next week, you know, you can have subcultures and variations, but when we think about going back to like something like food, right? Japanese, you know, cuisine incorporates a lot of seafood, a lot of fish, right? And the reason, you know, if you just think about it for a little bit, you know, it's linked to the fact that Japan's an island, right? So people use what they have access to. Food that is, you know, like for example, you can look at like, let's talk about like soul food, right? You know, soul food will incorporate some parts of the animal that, you know, animals that aren't the most desirable parts. Like, you can think about something like chitlins or even collard greens, which is, a weed, kind of. But you have to think about where it emerged from, right? You know, Southern cooking or part of Southern cooking emerged from the reality that many poor Southerners, especially poor Black Southerners, didn't have very much as far as means of acquiring the best cuts of meat or the best vegetables for their food. So what they did is they made do with what they had available. And over time, you know, they perfected it, right? So if you're going to eat, you know, the intestines of an animal, you know, you might add spices and things like that. But, you know, what we're looking at is how class is linked to that, right? Basically, poor people have access to, the less desirable parts of an animal, but they still have the necessity to, eat, right? We can look at housing, right? You know, this is a material good, right? And here in the United States, we saw, you know, we know how our houses are built, how we live, and how they are status symbols, right? They're much more than just a place to shelter you from the elements or to go home after work. But if we look at the history or just globally of how people make their homes, they're also adapting to the environment and other social forces. Like, for instance, the Inuits in, you know, the polar regions, they will build homes out of snow. That's what they have available. Or in desert climates, people will wear canvas and make their homes out of canvases. Or if they're, you know, nomadic, they might, take those things with them. Some places in the world use, you know, cinder block because it's cheaper, or make homes out of adobe, or, mud and, straw, because that's what's accessible. That's what they have access to. Right. So, I mean, culture is reflected on what through what people create and what people consume. Right. So when we think about our own culture, you know, think about how you're influenced. Right. Something that we might want to think about and we'll discuss next week is how we create our identities. Right. You know, like every morning you pick out clothes. Right. You pick out what to wear, and what you wear is a reflection of who you are. Right. But it's also a conversation of what groups you belong to. So, you know, one of the interesting things is that we can have a spectrum here. Right. You have your self identity. You know, the parts of you that are uniquely you that no one else shares. Right. You're one of a kind. And then on the other end, you have your social identity. these groups that you get lumped into, right? Like for instance, gender. Everyone, for the most part, is lumped into, you know, this traditional view of gender as male or female. As we get into gender and sexuality, we'll also challenge this, right? But if you don't fall into those roles, you know, you have to navigate them. You have to maybe even claim your own gender identity away from the dominant, like hegemonic or heteronormative, you know, culture. But before we go that far, right, you know, culture, you know, indicates, okay, you know, these type of clothes are for men and these type of clothes are for women, right? If, you know, sometimes you see people who choose to break that norm, right? And sometimes we have a reaction, right? And, you know, when we talk about like awkwardness or you know, when things feel, you know, a little bit off, sometimes it's that that's the physical reaction to some of those norms that, you know, are being challenged, right? Going into it further, right? We all are individuals. We all pick our clothes. But for most of us, when we go shop for clothes, right, we usually pick it out of a rack where there are multiple sizes, multiple copies of the same clothes, you know? But still, we're choosing these mass, these pieces of clothing that are mass, you know, are reproduced in mass quantities to define our identity, right? Or, you know, something that is unique to culture or to individuals is music, right? You know, you might wear your favorite band's shirt and, you know, claim your individuality, but you're at the same time, you're also claiming your group membership, right? Maybe perhaps so you can, you know, find others who have the same interest or who are part of that same, you know, kind of group. Now, something that we have online for you all to begin working on, again, we know some of you who are students in the class do not have Blackboard access. You will still have an opportunity to participate and contribute and, you know, get the points from this assignment. So again, the campus is working on it. We have a short video that's linked to the IDEA channel on PBS that I encourage you all to watch on masculinity. And on that one, you know, you can kind of think about how masculinity is challenged, how it's reproduced, and how some cultural goods are, or, you know, some media in our culture, certain media in our culture is only, you know, acceptable for one gender and not the other. And if and this is something that's being challenged, and it becomes, I guess, more easily challenged because of technology and the internet, right? So make sure you visit that discussion. We also have a exam that is going to open up soon, or is open, so you can start, taking that. The directions are on Blackboard, and you will, you know, just make sure you read them. If you have any questions, do contact us, right? We want to make sure everyone has a good idea. But that's it for today. We'll see you all next time and next week. Bye-bye.